You should be welcoming me, I guess, but welcome. Thank you. So Pastor Diane is on vacation with her family, and I'm Eileen Epperson, a friend of this church, and privileged to be worshiping with you this morning. In this silence, you may wish to pray a blessing upon the person on either side of you in this silence as we prepare to worship God. Come to praise God, all you faithful people. Come, for God welcomes you and offers to draw close to you. Come to praise God, who is as near as our next breath. Sun and moon and stars shine in praise to God. God created them and established for each a place. God has a place for us in this world and provides for our needs. God makes of one family all who dwell on earth. Come, let us worship this good God together. Let us join together as one as we call upon God's presence and unburden ourselves. Let us pray. Gracious God, yours is the gift of creation, the rebirth of spring. Yours is the grace that makes all things new. Yours is the urgency that challenges us to care for the earth. Open our minds to the mind of Christ. Open our lips and we will sing Alleluia with sun and moon, with mountain and hill, with all creatures of land and sea. Together we will sing awe to your splendor. Creator God, we have neglected our neighbors in their times of need. We have enjoyed profits and pleasures that harm your land and pollute your waters. We have squandered much of what you have made and called good. Have mercy on us. Help us change our ways and make us new, that all may know the joy of abundant life. We turn to you now in silent confession, seeking your mercy, forgiveness, and grace. God promises to dwell with us, to ease our pain and wipe the tears from our eyes. Dare to trust, for God accepts us as we are that we might become all we are meant to be. God grants us the opportunity at all times to repent and turn our lives around. This is the opportunity for a change, right now, right here. May you willingly accept God's offer of new life in Christ. Let us sing praise to God.
Good morning, everyone. This morning's responsive reading is Psalm 30, and it can be found on page 621 in the Old Testament in your pew Bible. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and did not let my foes rejoice over me.
O Lord, my God, I cry to you for help, and you have healed me.
O Lord, you brought up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit.
Sing praises to the Lord, O you who faithful ones, and give
For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning.
As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved.
By your favor, O Lord, you had established me as a strong mountain. You hid your face, I was dismayed.
To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication.
What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness?
Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper.
You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy.
So that my soul may praise you and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever.
This morning's Old Testament reading is in the New Testament. And it's on page 154 in the New Testament in your Bible, if you'd like to follow along. In today's reading, Saul is on the road to Damascus when he hears a voice and is blinded. He sees and hears just as the disciples have seen and heard, and he is established as one commissioned to testify for Jesus. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." Amen.
Will the children come and join me? Hi. Hi. Hello. I'm not Pastor Diane. I'm Pastor Eileen. Can you say that? Pastor Eileen? Thank you. So, what happens with birds at this time of year? What do they do? What do they do before that? Yes! They make nests. Does anybody have a bird making a nest where you are? Really? Really, where? Is it near your house? Where's yours? In the bush. Okay. Who else? Where's yours? In a tree in your backyard. Where's yours? Under your porch. Wow. Do you have one? Up in the tree. Well, I have two, not one, but two birds nesting. This has never happened before. I am so excited. It's right over the door that I usually come in, and so I haven't been coming in that door because the bird gets, she flies off, you know, to distract anyone who's coming near. Do you know, have you noticed that? Well, the second bird is now at my second door, building a nest, slowly. So I've drawn the curtain, and I don't go out that door either. Luckily, I have a third door. This is good. I don't know what I'm going to do if, you know, a third bird comes to that door. I'll go in and out of the window. No, I won't. So I'm talking today, I'm thinking about today compassion, which is really paying attention to what somebody else is feeling, especially if they're hurting. Now let me ask you about the bird. That little bird is not hurting, but if I were to have compassion for the bird, I know what I could do.
I could help her build the nest. I could get some little sticks and put them in and kind of speed things up. Would that be good? No? Why? My germs would get in there, yeah. What? Exactly. She wouldn't want to lay her eggs there because somebody disturbed it. So I was just thinking, you know, when you're working on a project and you really, really, really want to finish it, but it's hard and maybe you're upset, sometimes it's better if somebody just lets you work through it, you know, and doesn't kind of take over. And then there are other times when you would like somebody to come in and say, can I help you? So compassion, which means with feeling, has to do with paying attention, looking over there, if somebody's having a hard time, and looking to see what would they like, what would help. And there are no rules on this, because I might help you when you needed some help and you were feeling kind of sad, but maybe you'd be feeling kind of sad and you just kind of want to be by yourself. And that's okay. So today, after we leave, I'd like to ask you to find a grown-up, an adult, who looks sad, and just give them your beautiful smile, that gorgeous smile that's yours. Let's pray. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Thank you, Lord, for the birds and the nests and the beauty outside. Help us to pay attention when people are in need, and help us to know whether we should speak or be quiet. Thank you very much. In Jesus' name, amen. You can go off to your Sunday school. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thanks for talking. Love and obey God's still speaking voice. Let us give freely to build God's kingdom in our corner of the earth. We'll take up the morning offering next. Dear God, bless these gifts, and may we leave this place knowing that we have been given more than we can even imagine. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. A reading from John 21, otherwise known as Breakfast on the Beach with Jesus. Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" Peter said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time, Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter said, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." Jesus said to Peter the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because Jesus said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And after this, Jesus said to Peter, "Follow me." Here ends the reading of the scripture. May we be blessed in the hearing of these words. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be a joy to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A samurai warrior said to the Zen master, "Tell me the nature of heaven and hell." And the Zen master said, "Why should I say anything to a puny, worthless, miserable little person like you?" And the samurai warrior became enraged and pulled his sword and was ready to strike the Zen master down. And the Zen master said, "That is hell." And because the samurai warrior had soul readiness, he understood that he had just created his own hell with his rage. And he sheathed his sword and bowed down with tears. And the Zen master said, "That is heaven." So how do we create our own heaven and hell? Listening and compassion may have a lot to do with wherever we find ourselves at any given moment. Can you have compassion for yourself or only for someone else? How is it connected to love? Are love and listening and compassion somehow connected? So we're going to look at that. And this next part is the interactive part of the sermon. So I'm going to ask a question, and I request some answers. So I have 26 sheep. One dies. How many do I have left? Hmm? 25? 25, really?
19.
Any other ideas?
19.
19? Oh, you think so? Okay. Any other ideas? Okay. Not bad. Now, the person who said 26 sheep, I had 25 left, heard me say 26 sheep. But maybe I said 20 sick sheep, in which case 19 is the right answer. We mishear people all the time. All the time. We misunderstand their intentions. Even when we do hear their words, we don't know what they mean by the same words. We're always dealing with the consequences, though, of mishearing people or misunderstanding them. The capacity to listen begins with noticing how much we do not listen. Begins there. What would it take to be curious, to begin to take on an attitude of curiosity about how to listen more deeply? How often, without realizing it, do we completely miss what is behind what somebody is saying? What their meaning is, what they really mean by what they just said. Behind their mannerisms and gestures and tone of voice, we do not wonder what's really going on over there. Compassion is feeling for another in their discomfort or pain and acting to alleviate it. It is different from loving kindness, which is wishing someone well, praying for their well-being, without the intervention or the contribution necessarily. I had a graced moment of mutual alleviation of loneliness at an airport last November. I was waiting for the plane to, getting on the plane. We're waiting there at the gate. And on my right, there was a young white woman, maybe in her 30s, and then an elderly black couple right next to her. And as I was watching, the airport personnel brought a wheelchair for the elderly man, and there was some problem getting it fixed, and the young woman wanted to help. And so she got up, and the gentleman did not want help. He was embarrassed, clearly, he felt uncomfortable. And the wife was kind of watching. And it was one of those moments when you can just see. You see what's going on. I could see that the young woman just wanted to contribute. I could see that the elderly man did not want it. He felt ashamed, embarrassed, humiliated. The wife was watching and feeling for him. The airport personnel was just trying to get things done so he could get onto something. I just saw it all. And I looked at the man, and at that moment, he looked at me, and he glared at me because I'd seen his weakness, his shame, that he needed help. And I just stayed with him. I just stayed with him. And I didn't look away, and I just took it all in. And then I nodded. And he looked down, kind of something released, and he smiled just partially. It was a moment of mutual compassion and alleviation of loneliness. Now, I didn't have to go and recover from compassion fatigue. This did not take a lot from me. This was easy. This was nourishing. What blocks our naturally compassionate hearts? We tend to get locked in our thoughts, opinions, and points of view about people. We weave our thoughts together into a solid reality, all our judgments and opinions and prejudices, until we've made a big deal tapestry of it. And it is real, and we are right. Compassion entails facing and coming to be at ease with the parts of ourselves we have ignored or rejected. Compassion entails facing and coming to be at ease with the parts of ourselves that we have ignored or rejected. Our limitations, our mean thoughts, our determination to stay by ourselves, ignore everyone. Here's a parable. There's a woman sitting in a boat at dusk. It's a beautiful summer evening. She's near the shore, and she's just drifting, and she's so peaceful. It's wonderful. She sees a boat in the distance, and she's so happy that somebody else is enjoying this wonderful evening. And she waves. Nobody waves back. And gradually, the boat comes closer to her, and it's kind of aimed right at her. And it's kind of gaining speed. And she waves and says, "Hello, whoa, you're coming right at me. You need to go to the side." And nothing changes. No one waves back. The boat is coming right for her. And finally, she's screaming, "You fool, you're going to crash into me." And the boat crashes, and she sees it's empty. There's no one in the boat. How often are we screaming about empty boats? How often do we know that we have heard what was said, that we've seen what was really there, when maybe we didn't? That person is a grouch, we decide, until we find out he is in constant pain. That person is selfish and thinks only of herself, and we have evidence. Until we find out she has a sick daughter on the other side of the world and a possible lawsuit. He's always in another world, we decide, until we find out he is scared to death of people and has no idea what to say. It may assist us in developing a compassionate heart by realizing that we do strange things when we are in pain or afraid. We're lonely, and so we say mean words. We want someone to love us, and so we insult them. We rarely take a moment as we're forming our opinions to pause and wonder, is it possible I did not get the whole picture? We could say that God's realm is the realm of all points of view, all at once, the whole picture. That is not the human situation. Our situation is partial, ambiguous, confusing. We can only have access to one or two or three points of view at a time. We have to realize that we are not in control of a lot. I lead a weekly bereavement support group, and one of the hardest things for people to deal with is confronting our inability to keep somebody that we love alive. We cannot have compassion for anyone, by the way, if we're retaining the right to resent them, because resentment nails our foot to the floor, and all we can do is go around in circles. Resentment keeps us in the past, and you can listen and have compassion only in the present. Pema Chodron, who's a modern, wonderful Buddhist teacher, says, "The present moment is a pretty vulnerable place." The present moment is a pretty vulnerable place. And this can be completely unnerving and completely tender at the same time. Jesus was all about identifying secret suffering and showing how to end it, and showing each other how they can help each other end their secret suffering. Breakfast on the beach with Jesus. What could be more wonderful? What could be more lovely? And at the same time, there was a challenge being issued, an invitation. Peter is to go forth and create compassion in himself for other people, to nourish others, to proactively enter into their lives, especially those who do not have enough enough food, clothing, shelter, love, creative opportunities, worthwhile work, friendship, companionship. Then he is to train others to train others, and so on and so forth. So the compassion goes out and out and out, training the trainers. Between September 18 and November 20th, 2011, Pastor Diane did a 12-part sermon series on the Charter for Compassion, promulgated by the former nun and extraordinary theologian Karen Armstrong. Diane wrote, "Our idea of community has become increasingly individualized. Our tendency for self-focus continues to be fed by an international sense of entitlement. While technology has broadened our exposure to cultures and ideas far beyond our borders, our brains and hearts have not embraced those who are different as brothers and sisters." In another sermon, she wrote, "Compassion, according to Karen Armstrong, requires us all day and every day to dethrone ourselves from the center of our world and put another there." This may seem like a contradiction, she continued. Dethrone yourself and love yourself. But this is exactly what we want to do. We want to become comfortable with who we are so that we might feel free to offer oneself to another. Unquote. This church signed on to the Charter for Compassion. Y'all did, whether you realize it or not. Pastor Diane and Father John Carter in the Episcopal Church and I have been talking at different times and places independently about the Charter for Compassion. I've talked to the Jewish representative here, and I'm going to be speaking to the Unitarian and the Buddhist and the American Orthodox priest, John Krita. Pastor Diane and I are in total alignment in generating, in Salisbury, Lakeville, a series of conversations, a series of inquiries into compassion, community conversations, looking at what is it? What does it take? Is it hard? We don't have a plan that someone's supposed to fit inside. We don't have a blueprint. But there is a vision brewing. There's a vision brewing. And the vision is, what if Salisbury declared itself a town of compassion? Danbury has. West Conn University has declared itself a university of compassion. Board of Governors voted that. And what if this started spreading around other towns in Connecticut? What could the impact be if Connecticut declared itself a state of compassion? Can you imagine the impact on our country? The impact on the world? Everyone knows they have something inside themselves which they have not expressed and which they want to express. What role might you find for yourself in such an initiative? Does it call to you? So, winding up. Listening and compassion. What can we do now about forgiveness? So this is the practical part here. We can begin today to practice forgiving ourselves and coming to be at peace with aspects of ourselves we have ignored or rejected. You can take the phrase, "I'm willing to forgive myself," and use it several times throughout the day, especially when that critical voice goes off. About listening, we can interrupt our automatic ways of not listening by cultivating curiosity. An attitude of wonder, wondering. I wonder what he meant by that. What else would she like to say? I wonder. Just cultivating a curiosity. About compassion, begin by locating tenderness that you already have without effort. For a child, a plant, a tree, a garden, an animal. Start there. And then just begin to expand it. Fan the flames of the natural sweetness that is in you. I close with the first part of a longer poem by John Fox called Finding What You Did Not Lose. When someone deeply listens to you, it is like holding out a dented cup you've had since childhood and watching it fill up with cold, fresh water. When it balances on top of the brim, you are understood. When it overflows and touches your skin, you are loved. When someone deeply listens to you, the room where you stay starts a new life, and the place where you wrote your first poem begins to glow in your mind's eye. Amen. Let us be in silence. Let us pray. Beloved source of our lives, we praise you for the world and its mystery, for the earth, for beginnings and endings and the long in-betweens. We pray blessings upon those who are depressed, at war with themselves, at war with others, sick, in physical pain, lost in their lives, or grieving. We ask that you melt hardened hearts in your marvelous and unpredictable way. May our civic leaders discharge their responsibilities with a clarity of mind and conviction that is wise and informed. We pray for President Obama, and for civil discourse in Congress and in all our communities. May those who have power wherever they are be humbled and guided by the consideration of the impact of their decisions. We pray for those who have no homes, no families. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. We offer you all our children and all parents and grandparents, all families and all who live alone. May they learn the path to life from one another. Please show us the way to peace in the Middle East, peace in our families, peace in the halls of Congress, harmony in our cities and our farms. We offer our thanksgiving, our praise, and our concerns. We bring to mind the people and situations that touch our lives and ask that you bless them all in this silence. Above all, we praise you for Jesus of Nazareth, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Yet to be. As you now move out into the village, be renewed in hope with new energy. As you travel further out into the world, be curious about God's grace appearing in the lives of other people. As you step boldly into the world, share the good news of what God is doing for you right now. And may the blessings of God, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.